For starting, let me do a brief presentation of our company. Swissquote is a leading provider of online financial and trading services. We are listed on the 6th Swiss exchange since May 2000, and we have headquarters in Geneva and offices in Zurich, Bern, Dubai, Luxembourg, London, Malta, Hong Kong, and Singapore. Swissquote MEA LTD holds a Dubai Financial Services Authority, DFSA, Category 4 license. Swissquote MEA LTD acts as the relationship manager for your account, which is held offshore in Switzerland. Your deposit and assets are held securely in Switzerland with the Swissquote Bank LTD. You can find here our contact details. Drop an email to ea.sales@swissquote.ea, as you can see here below the customer care center. You find also the phone number and our address. Anyway, you can visit anytime swissquote.ea if you need to get more information. Let's start now our live session with Ron William, Market Strategy as RW Advisory and member of the International Federation of Technical Analysis. Welcome, Ron. How are you today?
I'm great, thank you. Really excited about this webinar, Seeking Alpha in a VUCA World, and I'll explain what VUCA means in a moment. Just going to share the screen, and as we do, if we could give a warm welcome to all our UAE and GCC attendees, and also those of you who have attended from other parts of the world, could we get a quick show of hands? Who do we have on online, and which country or which part of the UAE are you from? And as we get that share, hopefully you should be able to see my screen. So I'm going to do a quick video and sound check. Stefano, is the screen okay?
Yeah, the screen is okay, and we have some answers. So we have George from Brazil, living in Dubai, and Mark from Switzerland. Only two people answering, so please don't be shy, answer to our question. So anyway, I can confirm that yeah, we can see your monitor with the cover of this webinar.
Great. So we have an opening picture of a roller coaster ride, and what a roller coaster ride this year has been so far. We're barely into Q2, and wow. So a very topical and timely discussion to discuss what you will learn as VUCA, what happens when the world turns upside down, and I'll be more specific very soon. Now, as Stefano very kindly introduced myself and just general background, Ron William, 20-year track in the market, focusing on markets and mind, so the behavioral side of why we do what we do. Throughout that time, I focused on kind of a global cross-asset top-down approach driven by cycles and proprietary timing indicators. And on the behavioral side, I am an active performance coach working with traders and investors, focusing on a whole bunch of different techniques, including risk assessment, neurobody science, and just general stress response management, which has become very topical these days. And as mentioned just at the beginning there, education has always been at the heart of my work all this time, and still is. And so I'm driven very much by high integrity education. And as part of that mission, serve on the board of the International Federation of Technical Analysis. They basically host the gold standard diploma in technical analysis, the CFTE. And also I do similar work for nonprofit societies in Switzerland, the host country of our sponsor broker, Swissquote, and that is with the Swiss Association of Market Technicians. Okay, so that's me. And if you want to stay in touch via social media, please do, or just directly on the email there on the screen. Now, a big thank you to our sponsors, Swissquote, actually in the Middle East, based in the UAE. Of course, it is very much a global family of offices around there. And so, yes, this is our debut webinar education series for the Dubai office. And of course, disclaimers are key for all financial presentations, and just to stay true to that, the content of the webinar is purely informative and does not constitute recommendation for any decision and is not unsolicited advice for any legal or tax questions. Now, I want to begin with the end in mind, as the saying goes, and play a video that I recorded back when I was in Hong Kong, Asia, where I sometimes spend my time throughout the year in the business focus. And in this 3-minute video, you'll get what has been shared as a 3-hour discussion, but you're only going to get 1 hour of it today, you'll be happy to know. So 3 minutes, 3 hours and 3 minutes. If you can just listen very keenly to the video that I'm about to play now. The sound should be clear, the video might be a little bit slow, but just bear with me and take note of the key messages, please.
What does volatility mean to you? Risk, opportunity, or uncertainty? In life and in markets, our beliefs shape our strategies and behavioral reactions, especially during heightened change, stress, and disruption. Investing or trading in the future is not easy, more so during these uncertain, unpredictable VUCA worlds. VUCA is a universally recognized acronym meaning volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. This is a military term which is used during mission-critical times, those so-called unknown unknowns during the fog of war. The intensity of the military battlefield is a useful metaphor for the current financial market landscape. 2020 has already kicked off with a mini market shakeout, a rise in the geopolitical risk premia, leading to a spike in oil prices, Brexit divorce after a 3-long-year holding pattern, and the unfortunate recent developments with the coronavirus alert. All this against the backdrop of the late economic cycle, market fragility, and ongoing socio-political unrest. So how do we seek alpha in a VUCA world? Here are 3 practical steps. 1, resilience, both in market and mind terms. Market, an all-weather investment process, blended with active market timing overlays, in combination with astute risk management and, on the mind side, self-awareness in order to reduce behavioral biases and improve stress response management. 2, divergent thinking, probabilities, not certainties. Let's reduce the linear one-way bet investment strategies and include a focus on hedging some of the white or black tail risk. 3, optionality, multiple scenario planning, based on past anomalies. History might not repeat, but it often rhymes. Remember, it's the set of the sail of your market and mind strategy, not the level of volatility, that will ultimately lead to your success. Keep on keeping on. See you next time with Market and Mind.
Okay, so that's the 3 hours and 3 minutes you just saw there, hosted in Hong Kong, Asia. And so I flip it back to you. What does volatility mean to you? That opening session I asked there, Stefano, all the way in Europe or Italy more specifically, has the questions ready for you all as a survey poll. So we want to keep this interactive from the very start. What does volatility mean to you? You should get this pop-up question that you can vote on any moment now.
Okay, so I start with the first.
Yes, please.
Okay, so
the choices
first
are...
one is what does volatility mean to you? You can provide one answer. Do you want me, Ron, to close it in some seconds, and then we discuss it, and then we open the others? Three over.
Yes, so the first one for now, and then we'll have the others following up in a short while. So the three options are risk, opportunity, or uncertainty. Risk, opportunity, or uncertainty. Which one meaning would you choose for the word volatility, either for yourself or for maybe the employee you work for, clients you manage money for, whatever it might be, your trading book? What's your experience of volatility? Risk, opportunity, or uncertainty?
Okay, so 67% of people, they voted. I don't think you see the result here. Let me close it.
Okay, please do.
Now 72%, let me take the...
So which one is the winner then?
We don't have any winner. We don't have any winner because we have 10% for risk only, and then 45% opportunity and 45% uncertainty, and 74% of people connected voted.
Okay, so at least we have full commitment or majority commitment by the audience, which is great. Big congrats, everyone. Thank you for being engaged at the very beginning. And very interesting results. I've ran this survey across Asia and now in Europe, and it's really interesting doing the survey at different points in the cycle. So it sounds from the results that you've shared, Stefano, that there's a tie between opportunity and uncertainty. Is that correct?
Yeah, there is a tie, and only 10% they vote for risk. So 45% opportunity, 45% uncertainty, and only 10% risk. Do you want me to go ahead with the second one?
Not yet. We'll get to that soon. Thank you very much. So just a quick interpretation of that, and great, Stefano has managed to put the results there for us to see. I mean, most people, there is no right or wrong answer, and I think it's interesting that it's an even tie between uncertainty and opportunity. I think certainly on the optimistic side, anyone that sees volatility as an opportunistic moment in time will at least be well positioned as a trader or investor. And I think that's the key thing. One person's risky environment will be another person's opportunity. So we must see the flip side of someone's pain in order to experience the pleasure of the risk and reward payoff in markets. It's the simplest way for me to say it. Now, uncertainty is an interesting one because different people deal with uncertainty in different ways. Now, the majority of people around the world, based on psychology studies that I've been reading, don't like uncertainty. But actually, if you think about it, those who are in high performance professional work, like athletes, like soldiers in the military, and actually, you guessed it, traders and investors, we should be able to deal with uncertainty. So really kind of interesting to ask yourself, if you chose uncertainty out of the 40%+, why did you choose uncertainty? Is it because you see that as a trade advantage, or is it because you genuinely see it as uncertainty and you're nervous about uncertainty? So if we can get a quick kind of share in the chat box, for those of you that chose uncertainty, why? Just quickly kind of give a little bit of a reasoning behind that. And for those of you that chose opportunity, maybe share as well. So I'm going to move on to the next slide just to focus on the context behind all of this. Having just flown in from Asia, literally by pure miracle with the whole pandemic shutdown, difficult to find flights, one of the key things that I learned from Eastern and Chinese philosophy is this double-sided nature to life and markets. And so they have this beautiful symbolic name for yin and yang. It's the dualistic side of life and markets. And the actual heart of this meaning with the word volatility or crisis or even risk is opportunity. It's an ancient Chinese proverb. And even way back in the 1960s, a famous US president, John F. Kennedy, much loved at that time, actually had publicized this in his political speeches, saying that the writing of the word danger actually meant the same, had a different opposite meaning for opportunity. So just intrinsic in Eastern philosophy, and perhaps something that we can learn during this moment of crisis. Something I've been saying in previous Swissquote webinars is learning how to be calm while in the eye of the storm. And so crisis, storm, the point is we need to be in the zone to identify the opportunity and to be able to actually do well during that time. Now, why does this all matter? Because obviously the world has turned upside down. You don't need me to tell you that, but let's actually share with you a chart which actually had predictive power before we actually go into this latest storm. And this is something that I was predicting for some years. A lot of the time, certainly last year, people were ignoring me, disagreeing with me, which I'm perfectly fine with. That's what makes a market. But what really got me concerned last year, 2019, was most people were enjoying the honeymoon period of double-digit performance across asset classes on looking across the globe. And they were getting too complacent, too comfortable. And I kept highlighting this chart here, which is a chart of volatility based on the VIX, so the number, so the S&P 500 kind of strike prices of the option market. And you can see certainly volatility across this chart. And when I talk about 2019 being low vol, of course, if you look at the chart here, you can see it was relatively low vol compared to previous years. We did have the spikes, which I'll show in a moment, but the honeymoon period relative to the spikes before did happen last year before we had the liftoff thereafter. Now I'm just going to quickly delete that. And just show you how you can read volatility ahead of time. And it's this idea of double-sided nature of markets and volatility, what volatility strategists call mean reversion. That just basically means there's an up and down move to the market. High volatility leads to low volatility and vice versa. So there's an action reaction yin yang nature to volatility. And we can see here in 2015, high volatility was stuck in this 3-year compression breakout pattern, led to a big spike in early 2018, 1600 point cliff drop in the Dow Jones in just 15 minutes. That was the famous volatility margin call, where many kind of big smart money institutions lost money because they were shorting vol on the back of a very kind of comfortable economic low vol quantitative easing fueled environment. We then had an echo move happen later on in the year, Q4, which is what I call top of the pop. So the big, fast moving, uptrending stocks like momentum trending stocks like the tech sector, FANG in the West, and the BART stocks in the East, all of these fell out of favor and suffered a big drawdown. Of course, they're still strong companies, both technically and fundamentally now, but back then they did get hit pretty hard. And then we just had further echo movements. You can see 4, 5. And then finally this year, we opened up just after the Chinese New Year when I was in the region with this coronavirus alert. And actually that was then limited to the Asia region. It only then exploded later on from March onwards. And actually during that time, we had the oil shock closer to home in the Middle East when OPEC discussions between Saudi and Russia broke down, and there was the famous oil supply side shock. And of course, now we have oil at historic lows in the teens, below $20. Now, circling back to my journey in the markets, it has been an adventure over the last 20 years. And what has fast-tracked my experience, and I really want to kind of share some of the war stories with you as to what really helped me fast-track my experience and learn markets in a good and clear way. First of all, volatility has been at the heart of my journey from day one. I officially debuted into the market during the tech market crash of 2000. That was kind of as a junior strategist, learning the ropes early on and studying emerging markets, currency moves, and producing short-term, medium-term, long-term signals for our institutional clients. at that time, I was studying charts, drawing charts, as I was told to do by my mentor, and then learning the real heart of market analysis through trading and the whole psychology of trading. 2008, fast track 8 years later, I then worked at the financial media firm, Bloomberg, the Ferrari of financial analysis data. And through there, I actually trained traders, investors across the world. And it was a very critical time during the global financial crisis to see how the different banks and funds were managing their positions and developing strategies during a very difficult time. And then more recently, consulting work at a hedge fund and seeing kind of how some of the smart money was moving with our client base. And in and around all of that, volatility has been key and certainly a big fast track to the experience. Now, a question I asked
regarding the previous question that you asked, I received a couple of answers from Cameron some minutes ago. So you ask about the uncertainty, and Karen wrote in the chat nervousness about downside risk and lack of visibility on short, medium term price movements. This gives quite a lot of uncertainty.
Very good. So Stefano, could you repeat that just one last time? So uncertainty in short term to medium term?
So the for Cameron is nervousness about downside risk.
So nervousness about downside risk. Thank you, Cameron.
And lack of visibility on the short, medium term price movements.
Yes, especially when the market falls out the sky, cliff drops, and moves 30% in just a few weeks. I totally agree with you. And I actually am glad that we had a wide range of feedback there. Thank you very much, Stefano, for calling them out, because it's important that we engage and that we facilitate all of our experiences together, because that's really what makes a market. And of course, we want to make sure you walk away with meaningful messages and strategies from this discussion. And I think sharing the experiences really help on the mind side. Well, actually, it's a good time to put that in context. And so the uncertainty, the fast moving markets, all produces the roller coaster ride, which we began with on the opening slide. And here we have the emotional roller coaster ride to the cycle. Begins with optimism, peaks out with euphoria, where we have the maximum amount of money that can be made, but unfortunately, we take on the maximum amount of risk. So the risk reward is pretty poor. And then we circle back to anxiety, denial, fear, desperation, panic, capitulation, despondency at the bottom. When the market is most hated, that is when is the best time to actually try to buy at the bottom and catch the so-called falling knife. And then we go from despondency to depression, depression to hope, relief, and then back to where we started, optimism. So my second question is looking at these three stages here: fear, panic, and hope. Second question on the survey poll, which Stefano has ready there, hopefully, in a few moments. What stage do you think global or Western, and more specifically US equity markets, are in terms of the emotional, behavioral part of the roller coaster ride? Fear, panic, or hope? Fear, panic, or hope? Now, fear and panic are similar, but of course, panic is an extreme side of the spectrum of fear. Hope is the flip side, where you're potentially expecting a rebound from oversold conditions to hold up and maybe push back to the old highs. So, Stefano, do we have complete answers?
Yeah, so far 71% of people voted. Let's check still maybe 10 seconds. Maybe to go to 100% of people connected voting. So 81 at the moment. Four.
Let's break the record, guys. Let's get above 70%.
One. Okay, 81%. Let's close it and share with you. So we have 29% fear, 29% panic as well, and 41% hope.
Okay, we have an optimistic crowd out there. Very good. Now, just out of interest, this is actually quite a key question. The people who have said hope, panic, or fear, if you can all just throw in your own reasons as to why you chose hope, why you chose panic, and why you chose fear. if we can pick three different answers, just to give a qualitative check to why we have these answers. And please, as best as you can, give your answers fast. The first thing that comes to your mind, just type it into the chat room so we have a nice mixture of responses.
Fear, it is difficult to know how long all of this will last. And Jan, as well, I chose panic as I don't think the market has bottomed yet.
Okay.
And I have Steve writing, sorry, because now I have to open, I have to make the windows bigger for all the answer that we have. We had Steve as well, asking, I appreciate some words about WTI barrel, which is now negative. Is this a sign of extreme risk? Of course it is. And then, yeah, we also have to comment on this. And then we can also share the article we wrote today about the topic. And hope, according to Dennis, because market has touched a bottom temporary already. Shafid's fear because don't know where is the direction, mixed emotion. And Marcelo, it seems that markets are looking into reopening or restarting the economy. Jacques, buying in fear of losing out on the bottom. Penny, hope, timescale only in short term. And last but not least, Cameron, panic because of lack of comprehension on aggregate impact of virus.
Wow, we have a passionate, engaged audience today. A big thank you to all of you for speaking.
Gary is writing, market is hopeful. I'm not. I see much lower prices.
Okay, and that's interesting. I mean, I'll pick up on the last point there because there's a wide variety of answers there that really speak for themselves, and you're all very clear and authentic to your view. And just on the last point there, interesting to make the observation of what the crowd is believing, but perhaps not what you're not what you're positioning your trade as. So a lot of people will see the crowd as looking for a long, you know, rebound from oversold conditions trade, but you might be trading the opposite way. So one of the questions I've always been asked as a mentors have always asked me early on in the game is, Ron, what's the pain trade? And I used to kind of ask myself the question, what do they mean by that? And essentially, it's what's the opposite side to what you think the crowd is thinking. So just that last point there, who was it, Stefano, the very last answer? The name of the person?
Gary.
Gary, so great answer at the very end, Gary. I mean, all of them are great answers, but I'll just tag on Gary's answer. And it's really being studying the pattern, trading the pattern, but not becoming the pattern. So it's wonderful objective behavioral analysis that you're doing there by studying the crowd psychology, seeing that they're optimistic and hopeful, looking for the upside recovery, which is still holding, but being very mindful of the fact that you might want to do a short position because that would be the pain trade. So that question that my mentors asked me years ago was about looking at the opposite side of the crowd, the herd. There are times when you want to join the herd in a strong trend, and there are times when you definitely want to go against the herd. And so interesting to have a wide variety of answers there, especially at the end there with Gary. Okay, so I shall move on now with the rest of our discussion. And of course, that question was, what stage do you think we are in the market cycle? And just to give you a little bit of a high-level overview about my roadmap, which I actually learned from one of my esteemed mentors, Mr. Robin Griffiths, who published the book Mapping the Markets, which is actually published by The Economist. And in that book, which I recommend, it explains his methodology, which I have since learned and adapted with my own work, which sees the market as this asymmetric shape. Two-thirds of the move is up, one-third of the move is down. So think of it as a staircase move up and an escalator down. Obviously, the move down is faster than the move up, and that is partly because fear, which drives the move down, is faster than, greater and faster than the emotions of hope and greed. Fear is a faster and greater emotion than greed and hope. Now, from a business cycle perspective, there are different stages to the cycle: early, mid, late, and recessionary. For those of you asking where you think we are, my best probabilistic guess is that we're in the late stage between W and X, and probably we're just currently closer to the, let me see if I can try and draw this, to the X mark here, if you can see that, WX. Now you can move from X back to W. So we can move back to, we can move backwards on this model. And remember, this is just a model, this is not reality, but it's still a good model reference. So we're currently in X, according to my analysis, and potentially between X and Y, where we could have the big move down. If I'm wrong, it's the opposite. We go from X to W. If I'm right, it's X to Y, and then a big move down. Now, of course, it won't be a straight line, but it will be still will be more of the same in terms of downside scope. And during this time, you have different investments that work at different times. At the very bottom, you have value investment when things are cheap for a good reason, and you look to buy and hold. The famous Warren Buffett buy cheap, buy and hold strategies at cheap value prices. Momentum, when you get a textbook definition of an uptrend, higher highs and higher lows, a moving train, Newton's law of momentum pushing higher onwards and upwards. That's when most people, including the public, are buying. And then right at the top, where everyone is invested, there's no one left to buy, there's a big vacuum and a potential bubble. That bubble bursts, whether it's the COVID-19 trigger or anything else. The vulnerability of the market is high because everyone is taking too much risk in order to make too much money. And that is when active or tactical strategies, market timing, becomes very key. So does risk and money management. Now, cycle best principles, first principles, always remember history doesn't repeat itself, but it does rhyme. So we are looking for the historical patterns in markets and just general macro trends. Always have an idea of different cycles, the long term, the medium term, and the short term. And on the handouts, you can look more specifically at some of these specific points here about quantitative and qualitative measures that you can look for. I want to do a quick kind of current market snapshot now, just so you have an idea of where we are looking at global cross asset markets. And this is one of the first things I look at every day and week. And it just shows basically year-to-date performance across the key markets, G3FX, equities, commodities, fixed income. You can see there just straight away in gold, which is the gold market, holding up strongly on the top side. We did have a move down in the gold market, but it held up and is now rebounding higher. The currency world did have a big shock. Eurodollar alone had a big eight-figure move from 115 to just below 107 in just in a week or so. 115 on Eurodollar to just below 107, 106.70, I think, in just a week or so, when there was a lot of forced liquidation in the market, and so Euro was used as a funding currency, had to be kind of sold off pretty dramatically. And then, of course, we have the equity markets, the big cliff drop down, and now the rebound from oversold conditions, which could be a potential dead cat bounce, i.e., a sucker's rally, a short-term and temporary move up, which will likely push back down. And then finally, of course, in black, we have oil, which has been down ever since, year to date, but much of the downside move happened in March and now April. We've broken below the psychological record level at $20, and now we're in the late teens. Do have a snapshot look on the Swissquote .ch website, which gives you kind of a nice overview from a charting perspective, but also kind of top winners and losers. I've highlighted best turnovers first because you've got Amazon there right at top as being the best performer today based on volume. Tesla is not far behind, and Apple as well, so some of the big names. And looking at the winners and losers, interesting that you have kind of pharmaceuticals leading the way with 14 or almost 15% up there, another stock down below. Interesting also that we have a stock that specializes in vaccine, which is up 24%. And of course, with the whole pandemic situation, no surprise that the medical industry is doing very well. Any company that is associated with a vaccine or something to do with masks or something that is in high demand right now and will be for the next year or so, will probably be a very good buy once you do the technical and fundamental analysis.
Yeah, Brian, I take the monitor just for a while to show this, that is really incredible, is the price movement of the crude oil today. Now you should see my monitor that is simply displaying the page from the Chicago Mercantile Exchange Group. We offer access to the future market, as you said. You can trade the crude oil with us. And this is really incredible. It never happened in my life, and I trade since 2006, so 14 years. That it's incredible that refineries don't need the oil and are near storage capacity with most of the country shut down. And as you can see, the first future, the expiry date in May, that will be Thursday, you have a negative price. And then if we open the chart, it's crazy what happened today. So it is in extremely oversold condition with a negative price. And there is a huge contango. Contango is the situation with the future, with a next expiry. They have a higher price compared to the first one. So the contango is incredible also in the future market. So it's really, really unbelievable. I already shared with you the link of our Swissquote education blog on Medium that we just opened just a couple of weeks ago. And there is an article that I wrote, and then there is another article that Ron wrote today just before the webinar. But this is talking about the oil price. So you can take your time after the webinar to have a look. And this is really unbelievable. And then I also show the different ways how to trade oil. So you can build your stocks and bond portfolio. You can trade with ETF, and then there is a list of ETF that you can use. And of course, future, Swiss dots, and CFD. So there are several ways to trade crude oil with Swissquote. So I give you the right as presenter again, Ron.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And actually, just building back from what Stefano said, both Stefano and myself are really big on educational contribution. And personally, I'm very excited about this new blog now that Swissquote has launched. There are so many ways that people can absorb information and education, and certainly blogs are a key derivative of that, also the trends suggest so. And so Stefano just mentioned about the article on oil, which I recommend you all take a look at, especially with what's happening in the market this week. And you're all based in that part of the region where oil matters most. And then just on the left there, I'm going to do a deep dive into a blog that was just published before this webinar launched, Equity Market Crash, What Next? Please read it afterwards or when you get a moment. And for now, I'll show you the charts which are featured in that special report. Now, the first chart is showing you a daily candlestick chart going back to December, so a kind of year-to-date chart. And it's the equity market crash that we saw on the Dow Jones, 30% down in just a few weeks. Now, try to kind of focus on the price. I know there's a little bit of noise and new indicators that you might not have used before. It's my style of analysis, and this is the chart I use to actually take a short trade and to actually then share with the world my view on equity markets. And basically, the short position was at 33.40, having got bearish signals on the 13th of Jan and 14th of Feb. Moving average crossovers are always a good way to just to have entry and exit execution in the market. And what was very important, and one of the reasons why I made a marginal profit, not a big profit, so a small profit, is because the volatility was so high. Remember, the vol went to 2008 global financial crisis highs. And I really want to kind of make sure that I highlight these candle patterns that appeared in the market, which might appear again. So please remember that I said this to you today, because history might rhyme one more time. You can see these, what I call liquidation patterns, which essentially is where the market has a late intraday rally that gets rejected and pushes back down to new low breakouts. And that's what happened. Each time people went to buy in the equity market on a late intraday rally, some big liquidity pushed those buyers out the market and created new low breakouts. Remember back then, the exchanges in the US had limit up, limit down. So we had a big amount of volatility. And the headline news also shares that some of the big funds and ETFs got hit pretty hard. Those that had traditional strategies that weren't adapting to the change in the market, including some very famous big names, had to actually sell off their best positions because of the difficulties in the market back then. Now, since then, we've had a rebound within this kind of cycle window that I'm showing you. And the key levels on the upside are closer to 3,000, which is just above where we are at the moment. Now, the big picture chart, which I want you to remember for the rest of this year and potentially into next year, is the chart that shows that there is likely more downside scope to go. Now, this doesn't mean that there aren't good buying opportunities out there. There are, but you do also need to manage your risk above all in order to survive this market, what I believe will be an extended bear market in the coming year or so. So I don't say that to make you feel negative or to depress anyone. I say that because the name of the game to trade and invest successfully is to be prepared. If you are prepared, then you've won half the game already. If you're unprepared, then you get caught out like most people did earlier this year, which, to be frank, pandemic, who the hell would have expected that to happen? But at least if you had seen the markets looking overbought, looking like it was going to turn into kind of a corrective nature, you wouldn't have known about the pandemic, but you would have at least been prepared from a trading position. And here what it shows is this 30-year chart on the S&P 500. I've drawn this statistical linear trend from the 1987 crash. I won't go into why that is important. I mean, obviously, it's an important point in time, but the technicals have this very interesting way of vibrating to a certain price level, even if it's that far back in history. And what you see now is that the move that we saw in the market actually exploded outside of the range of this trend band, one standard deviation. And you can see there, just sorry, going back to that chart, this was the bullish trap exhaustion signal. All the long positions basically failed, got trapped, and then it flipped the other way. Whenever you get a failed signal, you will get an equal to greater move in the opposite direction. Great, great volatility trade if you manage to jump on that fast enough. Now, the market is clearly in rebound territory at the moment, but if we do break below, I just need to read it out, at 2390 or 2380, that's the bigger medium-term breakout level, which would take us down pretty quickly to 1700 and 1600. Which is an additional 30% down, not on a straight line, but certainly a minus 30% additional downside risk. And what that actually means is a move back to the prior major peak levels at 2008 global financial crisis and the tech 2000 bubble, the two periods of history that I said to you were key periods for everyone around the world, but also for me when I was starting out my 20-year experience. Now, one point I want to make here is that a lot of people are comparing this pandemic event risk with other similar or event risks, so other pandemic episodes, or with other kind of shocks in the system, external shocks. And so the popular things I've heard are SARS 2003, which is a previous pandemic which was limited to Asia, or the terrorist attacks in New York, clearly not a pandemic event, but it certainly was an external black swan tragic event that happened in 2001. One of the key reasons I want to say this time is different is because of the market cycle. The market cycle will tell you whether whether this is going to lead to further downside or upside. It gives a really good early indication, not just on the market movement, but also the social mood that ultimately prices in that positive or negative information. So what we see here in early 2000s is that we were at the bottom of a market cycle after the tech crash, after the tech peak and crash. So all of that negative news, whether it was 9/11 or SARS, was already priced in eventually, because we had already fallen quite a bit. Right now, we're on the opposite side of that, where we have a record-breaking bull market in terms of the 11-year move up in time, but also the price record that we have been breaking month on month and year on year ever since. So clearly, the elastic band has stretched the opposite direction. And whether it was COVID-19 or any other event trigger, in the end, it will be known as the pin that burst the bubble. COVID-19 or any other event trigger, it will be known in years to come as the pin that burst the market bubble. And one quick analogy I'll give you, people talk about, you know, any pandemic, and COVID-19 in particular, as compromising those that are have weak or compromised immune systems. I want you to think of the financial market as being a living being that has an immune system. The financial market has, by most measures, suffered vulnerable immune symptoms for a long time. Anyone who's been calling the market top has been wrong, but it was only a matter of time that downside risk would have been triggered. And so I want to kind of share that analogy between pandemics and our immune system alongside markets, just so you can get a better understanding of the cause and effect that might be taking place here. Now, looking at the long-term cycles, we can see this 100-year history of data on the Dow Jones market. You have to look at the Dow Jones to get that much history. It is not a chart that you can look at every day, but this does give you a wonderful picture of how long-term cycles do exist. So this is my way of sharing an evidence-based approach with you all. And it shows that these cycles alternate from bullish to bearish cycles, which last on average from 16 to 20 years. Now, you can get shorter or even longer cycles, but on average, it's actually 16 to 20. And if you want to remember a round number, just think of 20 in the back of your mind. Now, during the up cycles highlighted in green, this is when buy and hold passive strategies work best. You can use your moving averages, you can follow the trend. The trend will be your friend for as long as you can imagine. You can lose some money, but in the end of the day, you'll still be okay if you get it wrong a few times, because it's a rising tide that will lift all boats. The opposite is true in the red periods, because this is when market vol is that much higher relative to the green periods, and active active tactical strategies, so technical analysis, short-term trading becomes key, and risk money management becomes paramount. Now, the key message behind this chart as well, on top of everything that I've just shared with you, is that there's a global reset period that is predicted between this year and 2023. So a minimum of 2 to 3 years of a reset period. Doesn't mean that it's a straight move sideways or down. It just means a volatile VUCA environment to come. Now, I want to kind of just circle back and end this this discussion, which is published in the Swissquote blog, on equity market crash, what next, by concluding on what a bear market looks like. So the big what next question is answered on this chart here. Now these are different pictures of different bear markets. The first one, figure one, is the actual one that we've just seen there, minus the rebound, the 30% crash in just a few weeks. So that's the 2020 crash. And that's probably best compared with the 1987 crash, in figure two, which was a short-lived fall. Then we have, so that's example one and two, which are similar. I call them the good examples. Figure three is more of a prolonged bear market, which can last anything from 1.5 years to 3 years. You can see there, I've just highlighted the time duration. The tech crash of 2000 is double the time cycle length of the global financial crisis of 2008, one point to mention. And of course, the correction that they both suffered was anything from 50 to 57%. So another 20% more than where we are now. And they're the bad examples. So good, bad, and yes, you guessed it. Last charts, five and six, are the ugly examples. 1974, when we had an oil shock. So circling back to Stefano's point about oil, we're on the low side on oil, but if we have any rise in geopolitical risk, I've heard many commentators talk about the geopolitical tensions between US and Iran, which kicked off early this year, and now between Saudi and Russia. So oil is really coming back into the scope in terms of geopolitical risk. Any one of these risks trigger in the coming weeks or months, then we could see further upside on oil purely on the back of geopolitical premium. Looking at figure six, we have the famous Wall Street crash, the one bear market that no one likes to talk about because, of course, it was the worst of the worst. But interestingly, the 2020 crash outperformed the early stage of the 1929 crash based upon the early stage of the bear move. So you can see there, down 49% in 2 months, whereas the current market drop was down 30% in just 4 weeks. So we outperformed on the short side. Out of interest, if you're interested on the 29 analog, we had a 51% up before we then had the 86% move down. All of these charts do not provide an exact model of what will happen in the future. The past, you know this, you know the disclaimer, the past is not the best indication of what will happen in the future, but it does offer us a historical rhyme, a reference point model that we can at least take on board. So here's my opening last question to you all. What bear market roadmap is most likely? The good, bad, or the ugly? Good is a V-shaped recovery, short-lived recovery, like the 1987 crash. So that means that the rally we're seeing now will likely to head higher back to old highs. The bad, which is the similar to, which is a U-shaped recovery, moves down, stays down for a while, and then moves back up. 2008 is an example of that. And keep in mind, that would mean in terms of economic growth, we already have second quarter negative. So we probably have second and third quarter negative, and then possibly have a fourth quarter or early 2021 recovery. That's a bad example. An ugly example is negative from now all the way until 2021 into a 2 to 3 year bear market ugly scenario. So Stefano, are we getting some brave and honest answers here?
Yeah, so far 67% of people voted. So let's give other 10 seconds. 9, 8. Anyway, then I have some question about the crude oil. Then yeah, I will show also the way how to find the future, how to trade it. So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Let's close it and share the result with you. Oh, so wow. 79% okay. of people voted, and this is the result with bad U-shaped recovery.
Okay, so I think most of you are being practical and objective in the sense that you think the worst is still to come. And I've heard different views as to why that might be the case, both technical, fundamental, economic, and also pandemic related. But interesting that most of you are going for bad and not ugly. There's no right or wrong answer, of course. We're all trying to work out what's happening here. And so, yeah, just to repeat those results, 48% bad U-shaped recovery, similar to 2008 or the tech crash. And worst case scenario of ugly, a reasonable amount of you think that it could happen, but not the winning amount of 48%. Now, I won't go into why, because we don't have as much time, but if you can type in your answers, you know, why you think it's good, bad, or ugly, That would be great. Maybe at the end, with any extra time that we might be able to roll over into, we can maybe share at the very end. Now, just one quick point I want to make about the 87 crash, just to be clear with you about my view as to why I don't believe it's the 1987 V-shaped recovery. If you see the 1987 crash happened on this long-term chart just here. Can you see that, Stefano? Can you see my drawing around that? Has that appeared on the screen?
No, because I need to close the poll, so I need to hide it. Yeah, so now yes.
The red circles around that blip in the chart, which is the 1987 crash, happened in the middle of a long-term 18-year bull market. So that's why the 87 crash just does not make sense to me as a reliable comparison to the one that we just experienced. That's my main point. The second thing is, I want you all to remember that bear market crashes are not an event. They are not an event. They are a three-stage process. And one thing I forgot to say, and I must say, it's a really important takeaway message, bear market cycles and bear market crashes are three-stage process, down, up, and down. A fall followed by a rally, and then the rest of the fall. A fall followed by a rally, and the rest of the fall. So we're potentially in that second part of this three-part phase. And for those of you who are believing that we're likely to see new lows, this is the make or break stage that we're about to point out. Okay, so I want to kind of switch from that back to this whole idea of VUCA, because we've just been talking about volatility and bear markets, but I want to kind of broaden it out further and circle back to the video opening that we had about seeking alpha in the VUCA world. Now, what is VUCA? You might all remember my introduction where I actually said VUCA, volatility, U, uncertainty, C, complexity, and A, ambiguity. And basically the story behind the story is the military, US military, a long time ago developed this acronym and strategy to be able to respond to unpredictable events in an extreme war situation. And it's such a very important strategy and training that many other industries like business and finance borrowed it later on. And I've been basically teaching a course on this subject for about a year now, but it really started to become attractive and in high demand, as you might imagine, following the equity market crash. And in fact, I was teaching this course in Singapore, an expanded three-hour version course during the equity market crash, if you can imagine that. So the question I want to ask is, you know, what VUCA experiences have you all had? You know, so one example would be the equity market crash that we just experienced. Another one might be the oil drop into the record lows, or maybe it was the euro-dollar big swing of eight figures from 115 to 107. You know, what was all your experience of VUCA experiences, and how did you learn from those VUCA experiences? So if we could just have a few shares, Stefano, on this one point, I do want to make sure that we engage the audience on this question, because it's the heart of our discussion. What VUCA experiences?
Yeah, also, I also had before some question about the crude oil. There was, let me check, sorry, all the questions. Dennis was writing, we don't measure yet all the impact, especially on the macro economy. Penny wrote, Fed will avert ugly impossible given Fed intervention. And Clarence, market has been on high moving up for an unusually long time, and a lot of analysts have been expecting a crash soon. And yeah, anyway, then I received previously a lot of questions about how to trade crude oil. So yeah, I wrote this article today also to help you also, because we have quite a lot of products to trade crude oil. I will show you the original one, the most used one, that is the future, and then there are also different ETFs. So for example, if you click from the platform on options and futures on the left, and then futures again, you will find all these drop down menu, but maybe, sorry, I'm not sharing my monitor, so sorry for this. So Ron, if you don't mind, I take the monitor for a couple of minutes.
Yes, please do.
Okay, so show my screen.
And while Stefano is sharing this, if for those of you who can add your answers to what VUCA experiences have you had recently, so VUCA, volatility, uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity, so anything that's really kind of shaking you up from market or mind perspective this year, it can be the equity market crash, oil back to historic lows, or Eurodollar, a big figure move, or even the pandemic itself. How has that actually affected your psyche as a trader or as an investor?
Yeah, let me also ask. Up for options and future, and then you select on the Standard & Poor and the electronic mini Standard & Poor, that is the most liquid one. Okay, and then if you want to trade crude oil, we have crude oil and the light sweet crude oil. Okay, so the WTI, in both cases, the difference is that the mini crude oil is 10 times smaller. And every single month. So now there is this case that is incredible, never seen in my life, that the first expiry date is negative. So people can pay in order to let you buy the crude oil future because the refineries are now full. There is no more space for crude oil in the world. This is incredible. And then the next expiry, the 20th, the ticker of the ETF here, for example, this is and it's on the ETF. Okay. Then let me check some other questions. Yes, how can trade Standard & Poor? Of course, we have a lot of products, but also here there is the most liquid ETF in the world. ETF. Point one. Anyway, if you want to find the traded fund, different sector that you can use the ETF finder, asset class that, okay, and then that you can trade on the energy sector. Let me read now some answers for your previous question. So the first answer was Jack. Equity market crash, volatility, uncertainty. Don't panic sell versus some say sell. COVID-19 uncertainty. differing analysts view ambiguity. Cameron was writing VUCA experience, ambiguity over drivers behind gold price bull run over the last 8 months, which has considered with the equity market bull run. This goes against most conventional thinking about gold as counter-cyclical to equities. Yeah, it's true that in some days, in a lot of trading days, in the last week, gold was not the safe haven asset as usual. And Gary wrote, Gary was writing that he had some audio issue, but I think that everything is fine. Can you please confirm via chat that everything is fine on the technological aspect of the webinar? So yeah, we had a couple of us were wrong.
Wonderful share, and I think this is such an important time for us to kind of express the experiences that we all have, especially the difficult ones, because that's where we can learn the most. And we're all, for the most part, isolated in our homes or in our offices around the world. So, you know, what a unique opportunity for us to discuss the big moves that are happening in the market. So I mentioned, for example, the equity market crash, the oil drop, which Stefano mentioned, especially in terms of what that means on the supply side, Eurodollar big eight-figure move. But then let's not forget the pandemic situation in terms of, you know, how that's affecting the whole world, but also our trading mindset. So great to share all of that. Now, I want you to focus on the key lessons from each of those experiences, because it's those lessons that will help evolve you all as successful traders and investors. Remember, a key part of my specialization is both markets and minds. So I do performance coaching with many professionals around the world. And it's really during difficult VUCA environments like the one that we're in, that it's really important to work on our bounce back muscle, on our growth mindset, and really try to develop a best practice routine on an active basis. Now, that builds us into kind of the final section where I talk about, just in a few slides, how volatility influences our mind. Remember, my focus, I've always said, is markets and mind. This is the mind part, which I'll briefly go into. Now, we have an ancient brain that is built for survival. It's the best way I can describe the reason why we make decisions that we make and the way that we live our life. We have an ancient brain that is designed for survival. And that survival part of the brain is often referred to by some neurologists as the amygdala or the lizard brain. And it's that kind of center in the brain there that's highlighted in the picture that you can see. Now, when we get into a stress situation, the front part of our brain, which is often described as the CEO, the boss of decision making, shuts down. It goes into semi-paralysis mode. And so the reason why we often make mistakes, logical, you know, no matter how rational or logical we are, we make mistakes, is because in a high stress situation, much of our body, including the most important part of our brain, the front CEO part of our brain, actually goes to sleep and goes into semi-paralysis mode. Now, there are many reasons why we might be stressed. A long time ago, it would have been survival-related life or death situations, like being chased down by a saber-toothed tiger. You can see that picture there of the tiger, really strong, big canine teeth. You wouldn't want to be stuck in the same room or even the same jungle as that tiger. Now, that was back then. Survival evolution helped keep us alive. But right here, right now, the worst experience similar to that in a financial market context is actually loss aversion. We don't like to lose money, no big surprise. But the experience of losing money is the same to the body as being chased down by a tiger. The experience of losing money is the same stress level to the body as being chased down by a saber-toothed tiger. And that's what a lot of people don't realize and really need to be aware of when they're trying to manage their emotions and stay focused in a high-intensity volatile environment. Now, separate from all of that, of course, we have overload from the digital information media. I won't go too much into that, but that's more as a sign of the times. I think the hard thing now with the pandemic that's going on is the amount of news headlines, mostly negative, of course. Everyone's looking at case studies and death tolls and flattening the curve. And then all this speculation about will it go, will it not, will there be a second wave? It's quite a stressful time from a kind of external environmental point of view, for the obvious reason that we're in this tragic pandemic situation. And as some of you already highlighted, uncertainty is at the heart of that. And so that creates an unstable environment for all of us. Now, from a brain perspective, what actually happens is that we go into this chronic stress stage, which from a brain wave point of view is high beta wave. So I'm just going to quickly highlight it there. It's the top of the chart. If I just quickly highlight it, it's this part of the chart here. That is your beta wave. It's a volatile brain wave, just like a volatile financial market move. And being in beta is a good thing if you're problem solving. That's what we get paid to do in our day-to-day jobs. But if we're chronically stressed, it's high beta, and we're chronically stressed and we find it very difficult to focus and to actually just stay in balanced. Often traders will switch from beta to alpha when they want to get to a creative stage and be a bit more focused and in touch with their instincts. And then of course theta, delta, that's more when we're going into the restful, sleepful state. Now, that was a little bit about the brain. Now I just want to kind of fast track into, you know, the behavioral side of how markets work. A very famous behavioral finance expert, Daniel Kahneman, has often said that loss aversion is probably the number one behavioral trap. The concept loss aversion is certainly the most significant contribution of psychology to behavioral area. And the main reason behind that is because, again, bringing it back to the brain, neuroscience is a specialization of mine as part of the performance coaching work that I do to bring it back to markets and mind, so you can get see both sides of the coin. The reason why loss aversion and just pain in general is such a difficulty for the average trader investor is because the pain of loss is twice as great as the pleasure of an equal gain. I'll say it one more time. The pain of loss is twice as great as the pleasure of an equal gain. So in a VUCA environment, in a high volatility environment, where we might make some money some of the time, but even the money that we make will likely be short-lived. We're more likely to lose the money that we make because we need to take profits quick in a fast-moving market. And if ever we lose money, we're likely to lose more money than we would in a bull market because, you know, there's asymmetric risk. There's the market's moving down by its nature and going against the overall long-term trend that we've been envisaging for our entire professional experience. And so that's what this chart shows. And you know, there's lots of science explaining as to why that is, but essentially it's, again, going back to the ancient mind built for survival. And so anything that triggers that life or death situation triggers the pain. And a big part of working a way around this and optimizing your behavior and your risk management is all built in being able to handle stress response management. And that's where you can optimize the body, optimize the biology, and even optimize this pain pleasure pattern that I'm describing to you. Now, the flip side to pain and to loss aversion is confidence and greed. And of course, you have this kind of beautiful picture here of this mouse wearing this crown of knowledge, wanting to eat the cheese. We're all, you know, here in Europe and in the UK, we're getting ready for dinner time. And so imagine us all kind of focusing on dinner. But as we focus on dinner, we're focusing on dinner at the risk of dying in the process in this mouth trap. So that pleasure of cheese, dinner, or profit at the expense of a life or death situation. Now, often traders and investors that get into an overconfident situation develop blind confidence, not just overconfidence, it's blind confidence. They have blinded themselves from common sense logic. And I hope none of this applies to any of you. And if it does, then just learn from the lesson. One of my first trades in the market, actually, I think it was my very first trade in the market, was proved to be one of the hardest experiences in my professional career, because guess what? My first trade, I made money. Yes, you heard that correctly. In my first trade, with not that much experience, I made money. Why was that a bad experience? Because on the second time, because I was, that then allowed me to become very overconfident. And in the second trade, I was so confident, so excited, and a little bit arrogant, in blind arrogance and blind confidence, that I really didn't apply any of the rules that I should have, risk management, money management included, and I lost all that I made. And then I then continued on the journey of trying to work out what happened by understanding the market and mind side of things. So if you are confident and you are making money, do think about the benefits of taking profit purely from a behavioral standpoint, because otherwise that greed factor does take control. And it's really important to be balanced and not on either extreme. My final takeaway to all of you with this kind of markets and mind focus, where we looked at volatility, but also the idea of VUCA, which was explained in the video, and then towards the end of this discussion, we're obviously living in a VUCA environment right now. What do we do in a VUCA environment? And my best advice to you is just three practical steps or practical strategies. First point is resilience. So I'll just highlight it there. We're looking at the top of this flowchart. Second is optionality. And third is divergent thinking. Resilience, I mean in terms of markets and minds. So markets, we need to develop an all-weather investment or trading process. So develop strategies that do well in markets that move up and markets that move down, in summertime and in wintertime. And I think the problem is that most of us are too used to being in the summertime. And now is a really good time to adapt from summer to winter, not just, of course, in terms of markets, but even the life winter that we're experiencing here as we're in this kind of pandemic lockdown. Now, part of that developing a strategy that does well during winter times and the difficult volatility is active market timing and risk management. Any of you who are buy and hold or strong trend followers, you really need to be looking to adapt your strategy to the change that we see in markets. Now, on the mind side, it's all about greater self-awareness. We don't know what we don't know, so we need to educate ourselves about the key things to help reduce behavioral bias, improve our stress response management. And stress is a real top one. I'm getting a lot of requests from traders and investors purely on the back of the stress that they're undergoing at the moment, which they want to fine-tune and optimize. And then divergent thinking is all about thinking in terms of probabilities, not certainties. There is no right and wrong. Understand that for every buyer, there's a seller. And so that's why I've kind of included these survey questions, just to show you that there are different sides to the same trade. And a good trader sees the double-sided nature of a trade. And that's probably one of the things that that is a strength of mine, that I'm able to see both sides of the market. And at no point do I, and some of the traders that I work with, see the market as a linear one-way move. Avoid linear one-way bets. This is a real problem for a lot of people that become conditioned to markets that move in one way for too long. And it's markets like this that will shake you up, turn you upside down, and make you think, oh my God, what is going on? So I really encourage you all to adapt to fast-moving markets, especially one that is likely to be here to stay. And one way of doing that is to develop an approach for looking at two sides of the trade. You know, at what point are you likely to be wrong? Where is your risk level before you think about your reward? But also think about the tail risk, positive and negative. Some of the famous hedge fund managers out there have actually made money this year. One of them is Nassim Taleb, who's famous for his work on black swan risk, so high volatility risk. And he actually made money because he took a little bit of his equity and bet it on the risk side of his probability curve. And so he had a traditional portfolio where he was in a buy and hold, long-term trending trade, but he had a small amount of the risk capital on a high sigma, high volatility black swan event. He wasn't betting on a pandemic, but he was betting on downside in the market. You might maybe use the option market, you might use an ETF or any other proxy that you might feel is beneficial. But please think about two sides of the trade. And then optionality, it's all about multiple scenario planning, based on not normal situations, but abnormal situations. So it's all about the stress test and being prepared. Remember I said being prepared is half the battle won. Being prepared is half the battle won. So history, you know, being prepared is studying is also about studying history, but not because history repeats, but because it often rhymes. And that was the bear market examples I showed you there, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I want you to remember this in the coming weeks and months, because this will help you navigate through any kind of volatile environment, no matter high or low it is. It's all about how you set the sail in volatile times. It's about being calm in the eye of the storm so that you can actually weather through this. And just a final word, people say to me, okay, so we might be in this high volatility VUCA environment, eye of the storm, what do I do? And so the what do I do part is a difficult question to answer, but I go to, you know, many of the leading experts out there, and one of the groups that I work with as part of my training work is with Euromoney, a big global firm that specializes in many things, including the lending industry. They actually are part of this group, bank credit analysts that specialize on the strategy side. And they ran a study on safe haven strategies during volatile markets. Now, they focused on different types of volatile markets, you know, when bubble bursts, when political events or flash crashes take place, or when there's a big spike or shock in interest rates, what happens? Usually they say, you know, the bond market is the safest trade in town. Some people might disagree with that for depending on the debt situation, your view on the debt situation. Cash, of course, is often king during high volatility times, but probably later on down the line, not now. But I would say from the currency world, the safe havens is seen as the Japanese yen, the Swiss franc, and of course, everyone's favorite investment in good and bad times, gold. Silver less so, because silver is the ugly sister of gold and often high volatility, high beta, so it doesn't perform as well in a long-term portfolio. So I know a lot of you are focusing on long-term portfolio analysis, less so on the trading side, but whether you're trading or investing, I want you to remember this screenshot. It's a very good study that explains, you know, where you would put your money. Don't put your eggs in one basket. Be diversified, but be diversified in things that work well during up and, more importantly, down markets. And so that leads me to the grand finale, final slide. Warren Buffett quote, predicting rain doesn't count. I am not here to predict rain, although that's what I've been doing for 20 years, predicting market trends and cycles. I'm here to talk to you about building an arc. If you think that the market's going to be going sideways or down, and certainly will continue to be volatile, then you just need to develop a strategy for building an ark. That biblical story of Noah back in the day building an ark because he believed the world was going to be flooded. Now, in a way, that flood's already begun with the pandemic. But the question is, what are you going to do about it? What's your strategy? And how are you going to weather that storm, however long it lasts, using a markets in mind strategy? And I've already given you my recommendation, and I will continue to do this, trading actively in the markets, but also educating and supporting you through, for example, my support here of the Swissquote broker platform. Now, we're a little bit over time. It is late at night in the UAE, and I'm sure it'll be different times in other parts of the world, but I'm here to stay a little bit longer, a few more minutes, if you all have questions.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ron. I think we already answered a lot of questions during the session itself, but of course, we are available here, so do not hesitate now to send your last question to Ron. And after the webinar, please do not hesitate to drop me an email in case you need further information regarding how to trade some different products like Standard & Poor's or gold that we talk about. And just to show you again maybe something from my article from Ron and the previous article that I wrote this morning about there are problems with audio right now, so there is some issue maybe when I...
Hello, Stefano. I think we're having some audio challenges.
In case you need to search for an ETF that you need. In this case, let's select energy. And then you have a list of 10 ETF filter for you, okay? And then if you need, for example, if you already know the ticker or the ISIN code of one single ETF, just type the ticker here. And then you can trade options or the ETF directly. Okay, so for example, this is one of the most liquid ETF to trade oil. Okay, and then you have the list of some other ETF here. Let me check if there are some other questions. Okay, so thank you very much, Tron. I think it was very, very interesting. We have a last comment from Ufid. Fantastic webinar and super insightful. Thanks, Ron, for your valuable tips. Thanks, Swissquote and the team for organizing such a wonderful brain power session. Best regards. So thank you very much, Ufid. Very nice feedback for you. And George writing, thank you both very much. Again, so if you need further information after the webinar, do not hesitate to contact us.
Thank you very much, and please know that you should have a slide pack being sent through.
Thank you very much, Ron.
Thank you very much. Have a happy trading, and be healthy and safe. All the best. Look forward to engaging with you all soon.
Thank you, Ron. Thank you all, and have a very good night. Bye-bye. Yes, the webinar is recorded, and you can ask the recording at the email that I'm showing from our website. Thank you. Bye-bye.